One of the things that I did with this presentation, I of course wanted to integrate the Lord and Schryver landscape projects that they did in Oswego. And that was very hard to do. The property, Gaiety Hollow, is now under a conservancy. And they started up in 2015. And early on in my project with this, I couldn't get into anything. They were so busy organizing and getting all of their stuff together that I couldn't have access into it. So I sort of let it go fallow for a couple years, actually. Then I got prodded by a garden lady to look this up and do a talk on it. So I started up again, and then finally they were open enough so I could get access into it and try to find properties in Oswego. That was a hard start. The definitive work, I think, on these marvelous ladies that set up the first landscape architecture firm in the Pacific Northwest in 1929 is of Valencia Libby. This is a really neat book. It's everywhere online. It's at Gaiety Hollow as well. If you're interested at all in what we're talking about, look this up and come look at this when I'm all done too. So these two ladies were East Coast, West Coast. Elizabeth Lord was born and raised in Oregon, and Edith Schyrver was born and raised in Kingston, New York, about 91 miles north of New York City. June 10th, 1927, the two ladies met at a dinner party. Edith Schyrver was very petite, about 5'4" and maybe 99 pounds, was seated at the dinner when this SS Andina left Montreal on a tour group with Cambridge and Lothrop School of Landscape Architecture for a European tour. They had 20 ladies that went, and then three guardians, if you will, to take them. So on June 10th, Edith went to dinner, and the steward sat her at a child's table. And she said, well, okay, this is how this is all going to work, but I think I'm supposed to be with the group. They would not serve her wine because she was too young. She was 25 or 6. So she caused a fuss. Then they sat her next to Elizabeth Lord. And that's how these two met, spent the rest of their lives together, actually. Both went to Lothrop in Massachusetts. It's a landscape architecture school for women. Run by Judith Lowe. And Edith Schyrver actually was younger by 14 years, but went and graduated earlier than Elizabeth Lord did. She came in 1926. Schyrver had already graduated and was working in New York at that time, but that's how these two met. These are the ladies, Edith Schyrver on the left and Elizabeth Lord on the right, with their picture taken just as they got into, came back from the East Coast after after Elizabeth graduated. And they're standing in front of a property called Deepwood in Salem. And again, this is Gaiety Hollow. The Lord family were essentially aristocrats, Oregonian aristocrats. They lived just outside of Salem in 1895. That they moved there and set up in about 1880 or so. And pretty much these stars show the properties that are of interest in the Lord family. The red dot is Gaiety Hollow. The pink dot is the Bush Estate. And the white dot is Deepwood. And those two families interacted with the Lords very, very closely. But again, keep in mind that most everything where those stars are south was farmland. This was the house that Elizabeth grew up in. And again, you can sort of see there's nothing developed in this part of Salem. Now there's houses everywhere. But that is the Bush estate, Bush Pasture Park, it's called. And the red dot is where Elizabeth grew up. The red dot with a circle is the house of Gaty Hollow now. She was born where the red dot is, and she died where the red dot circle is. So she traveled more than 60 feet in her life, but I thought that was kind of interesting. But this is the west-facing house on High Street. This is where Schryver was born and raised. She was born in a house. Family had problems. They moved to a train station where her father, George, I think was his name, actually ran a restaurant at the top. So they were sort of economically separated, if you will, not only and as well by East and West Coast. This is Salem now, and you can see there's all kinds of houses. This has been a park forever. And the Bush House had Sally Bush, which were intimate friends with Elizabeth at the time. And this is Deepwood Estate, which we'll get to in a minute. But this is what it is now. Elizabeth's father was William Payne Lord. He was the 9th governor in Oregon. He was a Supreme Court justice 3 different times. He was a Salem City attorney. He was a war hero in the Civil War. Fought, got out, went to law school, and that didn't damage him too much. So he went to rejoin the military and the army, went up to Sitka, Alaska, and his job was to help convert and get the Russians under control, if you will, and get them out of the properties in the state. Did that, then he married Judith Cook Montague. She was a escort for Abraham Lincoln, and he finally, it was all up and up, but he courted her forever, but she just never seemed to take the bait. Eventually she did, and they moved to Oregon, where he became a prominent attorney and a governor and that sort of thing. Elizabeth enrolled in Lothrop School of Landscape Architecture for Women in 1926. One of the works she did, it was a rather rigorous program, a 3-year program. This is one of the works that she did. This is the kind of studies that they did in Lothrop. A lady named Stang actually invented or promoted the decoration of this. When you take on a project in landscape architecture, you have to do all of this, but this actually sold it to most people. Edith Schyrver, his father was George. Again, he was the manager of the rail station. He had the first car dealership in New York, and he ran a taxi service as well. And the mother was died in 1920, was a homemaker, and supported Edith quite well. After she graduated, she had a boyfriend at the time. His name was Channing Clapp, which I think is interesting. So Channing actually didn't seal the deal. She decided, rather than become Mrs. Clapp, she decided to go to the Pratt Institute in Brooklyn, only to study watercolor. The Pratt Institute, if you're interested at all, look it up. It's an amazing facility, still going today. It's sort of the residue of Standard Oil, and I don't remember his first name, but actually he's bought most of Brooklyn and then built this amazing facility that still is going today. Her only interest was not so much to become an artist, but she wanted to learn how to handle watercolors so she could do her plans prettier. She entered Lothrop and had an internship with Elizabeth Strang and Elizabeth Patti. She interned with Ellen Biddle Shipman. Shipman was sort of the cornerstone of their knowledge and their professionalism in this particular field. She's a remarkable woman. She graduated from Lothrop in 23, and this is her senior thesis, This is actually famous in this world. It's in brochures. It is still studied today. Its mastery is exceptional, and it is actually a teaching thing that they still do today. Judith Lowe probably was one of the reasons why these women succeeded. It was associated with, Judith Lowe went to various major institutions, Harvard and Cambridge and MIT, and sort of poached teachers out of that to elevate the level of intellectual acuity that the students needed. She bought this place, I think it was 9 acres. She staffed it with Strang and Blossom and Pattee. And her goal was to prepare women for professional lives and economic independence. At this time, there were only 4 facilities in the United States that would allow women to matriculate through this particular field. There were a total of maybe 9 or 10 at the time, but only 4. Berkeley, Illinois, Lothrop, and Cambridge were the only ones that let women. And they sort of started and stopped too. They would go for a couple of years and then run out of money. They would crash and burn and maybe start up again. But Lothrop was constant, and Cambridge was constant in terms of provided these women. It was a residential thing. She bought this, I think it was on 9 acres, and then she had dormitories for the girls to stay in. And it was very rigorous in the theoretical knowledge, the business skills, and practical training. That shows up pretty much every day in their lives as they go into their practice in Oregon. It was a 3-year program, and it had drafting, perspective drawing, freehand drawing, surveying, history of architecture, forestry, botany, entomology, and soil plant materials. Very, very few people. Elizabeth Strang actually was responsible for elevating the level of science involved in the horticulture that the women had to deal with for the rest of their lives. Ellen Biddle Shipman, I like her. She's a harsh woman. She was involved probably in the 1890s in the Cornish Art Colony in New Hampshire. Her partner was an architect named Charles Platt, and a journalist named Francis Duncan sort of captured really well what the Cornish Gardens mentality was all about. It's a rather large area. Has anyone ever been to this site? Anyway, it's beautiful. There's rivers and lots of greenery and big houses and that sort of thing. But there were lots of artists, sculptors, and painters and musicians and that sort of thing. And it lasted quite a while, actually. It lasted almost 40, 50 years. But Edith Schyrver was embedded into that on the coattails of Ellen Shipman. In that, she got sort of a perspective of the reality of what she was going to be getting into. This area happened to deal with large estates, vistas, multi-acre, 20, 30-acre estates, and that sort of thing, which gave her a predicate for designing on a scaled-down level residential properties as well. Shipman was really adamant about fine-tuning her skills. When you go to a property that's 20 acres big and you got a large flowing expanse down to a river with trees and that sort of thing, that's sort of easier, if you will, rather than to compartmentalize a smaller estate. Gaiety Hollow is only a third of an acre. It's the home that they lived in. It's sort of a test factory, if you will, for various concepts when they were going through their practice over 40 years, from 29 to 69. Shipman also infused into them the concept of views and visions of the garden. She developed axial lines of view, so when you're standing inside a property looking out, that the outside becomes part of the inside. The view and the plantings actually frame the perspective that you're looking at. And it's really, really important to pick the right plants to do the right thing and make sure the axial lines are smooth and flowing and colorful as well. So the gardens that they developed in smaller residential places became rooms. Each garden had a series of rooms. Each room was infused with a personality. And that's where the artistry comes in. And you'll see when we go to Gaiety Hollow how each section has its own personality. Shipman said, before women took hold of the profession, landscape architects were doing what I call cemetery work. Until women took up landscaping, gardening in this country was at its lowest ebb. I don't think so. But I love that spirit of confidence and aggressiveness, if you will. I think the Olmsted brothers and Frederick Olmsted would disagree with that as well. But it shows her mindset on how she was aggressive in promoting what she was doing. That aggressiveness actually spilled into Elizabeth Lord as well. When they started to set up practice, it gave her sort of the confidence to go out and get work. Elizabeth graduated. They came back from that world trip I told you about in the beginning in 1927. Edith Schyrver was actually working for 5 years for Shipman as well in her property. Shipman moved from New Hampshire into the city in New York and develop her own practice as well in New York, a solo operator of that particular firm. And Edith Schyrver actually lived in her house. She had two apartments in this gorgeous brownstone in New York. So she was working there full time for 5 years before she actually launched with Elizabeth Lord. This is their card announcing that they're in town. In Salem, which had about 4,000 people at the time, had 4 to 7 professional landscape firms. They sort of came and went. But these ladies stayed solid for 40 years. They had 200, maybe 250 particular projects that they worked on. Shipman in New York, working all up and down the East Coast, had 480 projects in her tenure, in her practice. So this is their tariff. This is how much things cost, which I just love this because it just shows you. When you read the history of these ladies' lives, you'll see that there's a lot of sniping by the owners of the properties, usually the husbands, thought that they were charging too much. But this is the tariff that they did, and they stuck to it. Elizabeth Lord, again, she was 14 years older than Edith Schyrver, but Elizabeth would take them on and wouldn't take any guff from that at all. That's sort of the Shipman influence, if you will, and Elizabeth Strang as well, that gave them the courage to sort of stand up to people. And Schryver, I think, has by far the most superior artistic and engineering skills, site analysis and drafted plans, and she was an on-site manager. Again, she would get in the dirt, and she would deal with contractors, cement people, land graders, all that kind of stuff, and the sellers of the plants as well. She would just take them on. Lord, actually, one of the keys to their success, in addition to their family support, was the social connections. It was first time she got the same day she got into Salem, she sent off 117 letters to everybody in Salem with a wallet and told them that they were in town and they were doing business and that sort of thing. She had upper echelon social connections, talked to the people that had money that could afford their services. Her aggressiveness was really remarkable. She was sort of this staid Victorian persona, you know, somewhat harsh, you thought, underneath all of that, but she was a strong woman. And she did the knowledge. Her mother infused, her mother fell in love with plants, and she became the first person to set up a garden club in Salem, and she studied seeds, and she did propagation work, and she just developed her little property there with the red dot, if you remember, into this gorgeous garden. And they actually did Home and Garden did articles on them as well, which on the East Coast, Schryver actually read those before she even met them. So Schryver knew who these people were before they even got to Lothar. Their first work in 1929 was Daniel and Edith Jarman. It's just around the corner, a couple blocks up from Gaiety Hollow. But he was a manager of a J.C. Penney's. He had lots of money for some reason. He wanted a Spanish colonial revival, which is almost unheard of in Salem at the time. But Edith Schyrver was passionate about Spanish work. In the tour that they took, these two ladies would break off from the tour, and as soon as they could, Edith Schyrver went down to Spain and investigated Spanish architecture, Spanish gardens. Not so much just to sort of look at what they were doing, but she went down deep and to find out how they handled the water, how they prepared the ground, how they leveled certain things. That's sort of the level down deep that she got into. She came back, I think it was in 27 or so, and Shipman gave her a lead project of Spanish garden in Massachusetts or New Hampshire someplace. And they developed plans and all that sort of thing. She took those plans back and utilized a lot of them, with Shipman's permission, of course, on the Jarman garden. And it's still there. It's almost perfectly intact for what it was. Charles Platt and Shipman actually did the Richard and Eula Merrill property in Seattle in 1909. By 1927, it had all gone to pot. So Shipman asked Schryver to go up to Seattle and revamp it and refresh it, if you will. They did that. Eula actually was a bit of a pill. Shipman would go in and she would order $1,800 worth of box hedge from the South, if you will, and ship them all the way out. So she would plant them all, get them all squared away, get roses or whatever she wanted to do with her vision. Then Eula would come in and like a month later and rip everything out because she didn't like what she did. So they had difficulties. But they actually worked for the Merrills on and off for, you know, well into the 40s. They actually had a victory garden designed in 43. Brighton Bush, it was built by Dr. Mart Skiff, and it was a huge thing. It was the only properties that they actually involved Olmsted concepts of vast vistas and that sort of thing, sort of English rural garden sort of thing. He was the one that they had a fight with. He thought that they were charging too much after they were all done, but they got him to pay. Pendleton actually was one of the properties in 1929 through 32. On again, off again. You know, they were hired by Pendleton to develop this little memorial park, and they developed everything. They did all the designs. They were all getting ready, and then it would shut down, and they would start up again. Only a fragment of what they suggested Pendleton wound up doing. It went in and out of commissions forever. It was just a mess. Drove them crazy. Deepwood was that property again, the White Star, if you remember. I kind of fell in love with this place. It had a series of three owners. It was built in 1894. By the time Alice Browne Powell finally got it, she became good friends and put the ladies on commission so they would go over. It's still part of the tour, if you will, of Gaiety Hollow. And it's a remarkable place. But in this, you can sort of see the scroll garden motif that Schryver absolutely loved. She put that in anywhere she could. Directly across the street from Gady Hollow is the Bush estate. Sally Bush was again a friend of theirs, and she hired the ladies to maintain this, to tweak their estate and make gardens and that sort of thing. It's really exquisite. It's an amazing place. Now, trying to do all of this, I want to sort of relate it to Oswego. The lady's story is interesting, but how does that relate to Oswego? So I had to go look for properties. And I think there are 9 total. I could only find 5, two of them in Oswego, 3 of them in Dunthorpe. And the Beebe Garden actually is in off of Boone's Ferry and in Inglewood community. It was designed by Ernest Fanning Tucker, which Schryver would butt heads with frequently. She actually would go to the property, to the designer, and she'd walk around and she would know in her head what the axial lines were supposed to give you. And she would argue with the architect, you have to move your house 3 degrees this way because the sun and this and that sort of thing. She would not take no. So she won every single battle getting the designer or the architect to move them where she wanted them to make her plants tell the story that she wanted to tell. Anyway, it was interesting. I actually went to all of these places, and I'll show you that in a minute. This is what it looks like today. There's fragments left of what they actually did. This is the sort of thing, the touches that they would do, a heather bank. Second property in Oswego is what I call the P.F. Chang house. It was Mary Scarborough Young actually built this, not this house, but the one before it. And I had a hard time. I was looking for newspaper articles about Mary Young and her husband and how they're trying to build things. 1930, all I could find in the newspapers was their purchase of 9 up and down acres on Phantom Bluff. Then all of a sudden, 31, they disappear, and then late 31, I find articles about the Twin Points on the North Shore. And these are some of the articles I found, and then they finally sold, she wrestled out of the Oregon Iron and Steel. This is where it is, actually. These are some of the pictures, these are the only 2 pictures I could find of the house, very little garden work. And this is the Kingery Garden in Dunthorpe. Again, Ernest Tucker repositioned the house at her request. It's on the crest of a hill. It was a landscape 5-year project in 1943, finally was getting started. But what happened in 43? Anyone that could carry a gun was in Europe or Japan or anywhere but Dunthorpe. So they had a hard time getting workers to do the project, and this was a big project. These are the Kingerys. That's the back of the house. This is a fragment of what was left of, it is still intact, of their garden. The Avison Garden, again in Dunthorpe, was Colonial Revival. I dislike this house. I think it's ugly. But the interesting thing about the property is that a third of the property is straight up and down. It's on Military Road and 43. And to handle that sort of thing, Lord and Schryver designed, cut it up into terraces. There were 4 total terraces, 1 in the back of the house, flat, and then they had an upper terrace, which was where the rose garden was, middle terrace, where they grew trees and fruit and that sort of thing, and then the lower terrace was a playground for the children. But I think it was a really innovative way to handle the geology and the geography of a particular property, how to turn something awful into something very useful and pretty. That's the upper terrace. That's the house and Mr. Avison. Again, I don't like the architecture of this. It's what it is. My wife Mona was a couple of months ago was reading in the paper and found this real estate ad, historic Dunthorpe mansion with marble fireplaces and Lord and Schryver landscaping for sale for $4 million. Hadn't heard about that, so I contacted Karen Freeman, the executive director of the Conservancy of, and this is the house. She had no idea initially, you know, the Conservancy had no idea that this was a Lord and Schryver house, so lots of suspicion. I think it probably was, they do too. It wasn't called Rossiter Hines house, it was actually called a Bishop house. And this is an aerial view. You can see Portland in the upper right corner. And that house there on the far left is the Avison house. So they were neighbors, and I think they probably actually worked on this as well. But the researchers at Lord and Schryver Conservancy are actually working on that to find out what this is all about. It sold easily for $4 million really very quickly. So this is my letter to Karen asking for information. But that letter sort of shows you how accessible these wonderful people are. Back to Gayety Hollow, Elizabeth Lord sold their house that she was born and raised in 1932. Clarence Smith was the architect, and he built this colonial and English rural revival for $6,500. Elizabeth Lord's only request that it was be comfortable but practical. And again, this is sort of the plot and how they began to design it. They noticed they put the house here in the corner, so they would have lots of room to build their rooms of their garden. These are the various rooms. I think there's seven of them. The drying garden. Anybody know what the drying garden was? We're all old, so we should know. That's where they hung their laundry. They don't hang the laundry there anymore, but they turned it into, but they still maintain the drying garden thing. But when I was a kid, I remember the spot on our property where Mom hung out the laundry to dry. And they're always doing renovations here. This is one of the alleys on the west side. This is a sort of view. They had this marvelous three-dimensional view over four different seasons. So they would plant things in and out to correspond with the color scheme that they dictated. It wasn't just putting a pansy in the dirt. They knew where every single plant was and what it was going to do seasonally. If you have not been to Gayety Hollow, it's about an hour and 20 minutes at most from here. I suggest you do when it stops raining. It's a marvelous place. We'll find out when they're open. They're almost always open. I met the master gardener of the Conservancy, a marvelous woman, is so brilliant with what she knows about dirt and plants and bugs and that sort of thing. She's also the gardener of Deepwood as well, so she works in both properties. Deepwood wound up with five different rooms that Lord and Schryver built for Alice Browne. So there's this compatible thing going on with the property. OCD. Edith Schyrver did this kind of thing. What this is telling you is that she knew every spot and the genus species of every tulip that she planted. That's how deep into this she got. She would make sure, and when the planters or the worker people that helped her do this would mix up the bulbs, she would take them to task. So, again, genus species, every single thing. And she could see, just out of something like this, the color scheme before it even happened. Experience, of course, but she had this marvelous aesthetic to her that would allow her to see the final product before she even got there. She would also utilize what she would call borrowed landscape, not so much in this particular property, a little bit in this, because on the north side, there's trees and things. But she would utilize neighboring trees and plants and fields and things in her work that integrated with what she actually did on the particular plot of ground that she had. Ladies were very active in the media. They had a radio program. They did garden design articles in the newspapers, and they were always in the Capital Journal and the Oregon Statesman producing this kind of work. There's, in this particular series, I think in 32, there were 9 entries. Every week they had a different garden plan and concept and the educational materials that they would provide to the public through the Oregonian or wherever they were talking about. They pretty much joined every club in Oregon, and they were instrumental in establishing the club if it was starting, or helped design the particular property in both the Salem Garden Club, Portland Garden Club, and we'll all up and down the Willamette Valley. This is the plan that they developed for the Portland Garden Club, which is still there. They were educators as well. They had on-site tutorials. Again, Gayety Hollow was a laboratory that they utilized to educate people about how to handle certain things. Big trees, small trees, rotos, whatever it was, and how to align visually particular plants to do what they're supposed to do at a certain time, to introduce different colors and that sort of color schemes as well. They had on-site tutorials for Brigham Young, of all places. The Oregon Society for Landscape Architect hosted site tours and college gardening college classes. They were on jurors, judges for garden clubs and that sort of thing. Schryver actually became a part-time instructor at Oregon State College, and then she actually taught after men came back. She went back to work and taught in the cooperative extension in Salem. This institutions, if you read about the institutions they did, it's like long. Pretty much, I think, every piece of green grass in the Willamette Valley, they knew, and they dealt with it. And the communities would come to them to ask them to help, you know, fix a particular garden. This happens to be Reed College, but they did, again, pretty much high schools, junior high schools. They did the mall in Salem as well, in Willamette University, and their favorite was St. Paul's Episcopal, which Mona and I have actually been to. It's remarkable. They had a particular fondness for St. Paul's for some reason. This is, again, Bush Pasture Park, directly across the street, across from Mission, from their house. But they did Salem Park and Marion Park and on and on and on. They did period gardens, 3 of them. Of course, the McLaughlin House, the Barclay House, and the Hoover Minturn House. Did you know that Herbert Hoover lived in Newburgh for 4 years? I didn't know that. So he did, and Schryver actually came and saved it. When they asked her to shape up the house in Newburgh, and when she got there, for some reason, somebody scraped all the dirt off of the property. So it was like clay everywhere. And of course, the trees that actually grew, that could survive, actually were like a foot above grade. So they had to put dirt back in, and it would just drove her nuts that somebody would do that. Elizabeth died on October 9th in 76. She granted Edith a lifetime tenancy of Gayety Hollow and left her money and the car and club memberships. I looked at the census records for 30, 40, and 50. Edith Schyrver is listed in 30 and 40 as a boarder. In 1950, she's listed as a partner. So, Edith passed away in 84, 7.5 years after Elizabeth. She left whatever she had to her nieces and directed that her body be mailed back or sent back to New York, and she was buried in the Wiltwyck Cemetery with her mom and dad. The nephew inherited Gayety Hollow and a house they had on the beach. the archives of them. They kept fastidious notes, and they kept, even when they were in Lothorp, they kept lots of notes and things. All of that went to the University of Oregon, and it's in the special collection 098. Their house became on the National Register, and in 2015, the Conservancy acquired Gaty Hollow. Edith said in 81 that landscape architecture is first of all an art, secondly a profession, and last of all a business. Most everybody I know that has that philosophy does not do well economically, but I'm kind of harsh about that. These women managed to make that happen. They were artists first, business people last, and they still survived quite well, actually, in what they were doing. I admire that. So, and of course, understatement was that Edith said that it was not easy being businesswomen. I went to see these properties. This is the Inglewood property, the Beebe property, and the Kingery, the Dunthorpe property, and the Rossiter Hines, which actually is probably the Bishop property in Dunthorpe, and the Deepwood. I've been, in the last 50 years or so, I've been in and out of hundreds of homes and restorations, Queen Anne's for sure, but this is one of the finest restoration work that I've ever seen. Their detail was beyond belief. It's almost Victorian Albert Museum quality stuff. So it's in Salem, of all places. How did that happen? So anyway, this was Alice Brown Powell's house, neighbors to the ladies. And this is the kind of work that you can see. They matched the paint perfectly. And the carpets, they had them fabricated as well. This is Alice Brown there in the Scroll Garden. This is one of the five gardens at Deepwood that you're looking at. They do income generation by having weddings in the Scroll Garden. Bush House. Sally Bush actually took the ladies in 29 when they first got there, because their house was being cleaned up, and the old one, and remodeled and made livable again. Literally was a shack built in 1880. And she hadn't lived there for 4 years since she was traveling. And this is a north porch. And if you turn around, this is Gaty Hollow. That's how close they were to their neighbors. I've been to Gaty Hollow several times since I fell in love with these ladies. And that's the front. That's the alley on the west side, or alley, and across axial line as well. But it sort of shows you how they designed perimeters of the view that they want to do, with boxwood hedges, rhodos sticking up, and the colors are quite specific. They'll make sure they have the right color doing the right thing at the right time. That's the back of the house. These two, if you're interested at all in this, they have this produced at Gaty Hollow. I think they're online too. Really interesting. So you may want to look at those if you want. That's the Heritage House. I'd given a version of this talk to the Mary's Woods, a group in Mary's Woods, and they made me go on a tour. So I crammed into this Mary's Woods bus with 16 gorgeous women, and they took me down to Gaty Hollow, and we had a wonderful, wonderful day. And Karen Freeman, again, your contact, if you're interested at all, is Karen Freeman. Marvelous woman, knows everything there is to know. This is the back of Deepwood. And this is where I live, 5 days a week. Thank you. You bet.